A little bit background about me. So I am a cloud security researcher with Palo Alto Networks. My research focus in the past few years has been around container, DevOps, and public cloud security. And in this talk, I will focus on my research around the infrastructure security in public cloud. So in the past, when hosting an e-commerce site, in the past few years, organizations are moving rapidly into the cloud space. And in the past, when you create a website using on-prem data center, you know exactly where you store the data, you know exactly which hard drive actually hosts your SQL database, and you know which Ethernet cable actually direct or transmit your data to the internet. But when you move to a cloud environment, when your e-commerce site now is deployed in the cloud, you have no idea where your data is. You know your server is accessible from somewhere, is hosted somewhere, and it is accessible in the public, but all over in the world. But you just have very limited visibility under the hood to what's going on below your application. So as a system admin, how can you protect your application or your data in the cloud? The good news is that the cloud service provider today take care of many heavy lifting and dirty works for you, such as reliability, load balancing, and throughput optimization, and they have done a fantastic job. And the second good news is that cloud service provider also mimics the on-prem data center as much as possible, so that you can configure your cloud infrastructure almost identical to your on-prem data center if you had one before. And in this talk, I will show you how the infrastructure as code can help you build a virtual data center much quicker and cleaner, and it can also be more secure if you do it correctly. So the agenda of my talk, the first half will focus on introducing infrastructure as a code, and the second half will focus on our research on exploring the public as well as private infrastructure as a code that we have access to. In particular, we pull around 500,000 infrastructure as a code template from the GitHub and analyzing using our infrastructure IAC scanner to identify to understand how people are using infrastructure as a code and how secure these IACs are. And in particular, we focus on four types of IACs in our research. We look at AWS CloudFormation, HashiCorp, Terraform, and Kubernetes YAML files. And finally, at the end, I will conclude the talk with some pattern and anti-pattern to make your IAC more secure. So the broader definition of infrastructure as a code is the process of provisioning and managing computer data centers to human readable code as opposed to physical hardware configuration. So virtually in the past, when you have a on-prem data center, you have a bunch of servers wired with many Ethernet cables nicely. And after years of maintenance, debugging, or patching, your data center may become a little bit messy, maybe not as bad as this picture, but just getting more difficult to manage when you when sometimes you need to scale up your data center to handle more load or business. And on the right is the virtual data center in the cloud. I see this as data center in browser, because I can literally configure and create a data center just by a few click, a few drag and drop in the browser. Then I have a data center ready for me in a few minutes. So this is like this is a screenshot from AWS. Although GUI-based configuration is easy, intuitive, but it is still challenging if you have hundreds or thousands of virtual machines to manage. That's why infrastructure as a code, IaC, come into rescue. You can essentially just specify all your requirement and specification of the data center in a piece of plain text file, send this plain text file to your cloud service provider, and the cloud service provider will magically create a full-blown, fully functional data center for you in just a few minutes. So the concept of IaC is not that new. It has been around for more than a decade, and there are many different IaC language. There are mainly two types of different IaC. If we look at the third column here, the first type is called provisioning IAC. This type of IAC focus on creating infrastructures such as servers and network connection. And this is the type of IAC that most public cloud service providers such as AWS, Azure, and Google provide. And the second type of IAC is called configuration management IAC. This type of IAC are able to manage, configure, or install software in your server. The biggest difference is configuration management IAC usually require an agent running in your VM or in your servers, so that agent can actually configure all your software, such as your web server, your SQL server, and make the patch or update for you. And it can do much more than the provisioning type of IAC, but these two type of IAC have some overlap, but their focus is very different. In our research, we focused mainly on the provisioning type of IAC used in public clouds or provided by public cloud. And what are the features? Here are some important features of the IAC. The first, it is shareable and repeatable. This is one of the most important advantage of IAC, because as a company, you can create a golden IAC and share with different department or different project. And each project can then create an identical virtualized data center for each specific project. So it's shareable and can be repeatable. And the second property of IAC is modularized component. So a data center can be built with multiple smaller pieces of IAC code. And this IAC code or IAC module works just like a software library. It can be shared and it can be reused. And this makes enforcing policy or standardization much easier, and also making creating a new data center much easier. And the third feature of IAC is IAC makes the process more agile, makes testing easier. This is because the data center can now be created easily and quickly. One can replicate an identical production environment to test. One can easily replicate an production environment to test a new code. So in the past, we all have experienced that a piece of code piece of code is fully functional in the dev environment, but when this code is moved to the production environment, it just failed horribly. And most of the time, the reason is that there is a drift between your dev environment and your production environment. Your production environment is not identical to your dev environment, so that the one piece of code may work in dev but doesn't work in the production environment. With IAC, we can easily remediate this issue because each IAC can create multiple identical environments. And if anything goes wrong in your production or in your dev environment, or if anything, any configuration is screwed up, you can easily just destroy the existing environment and recreate one quickly. So that's the beauty of the IAC. And the last one, statistic analysis. This is what our focus is. Before going to the static analysis on IAC, let me first talk about a little bit about the shift lab. The concept of the shift lab, again, is not new. It means focus on moving the test as early as possible in software development lifecycle with the goal of preventing issue instead of detecting issue. So instead of testing your code at the last stage of development, shifting left encourages you to incrementally test each small piece of your code or a function as early as possible to identify and address the issue as early as possible. And when the concept is applied to the security, it means we want to identify the security issue as early as possible. And instead of scanning your entire application before deploying to the production, this is how we scan vulnerabilities in the past. Now, with the concept of shift lab, we want to identify the security issue at the developer development stage. Like, we want to install an IDE plugin to identify the security issue even when the developers are writing the code, so that this issue can be addressed and removed as early as possible and never get into the development pipeline. And when talking about shift left, most people think about identify the vulnerable package, the vulnerable applications in the software development pipeline. But now with infrastructure as a code, we can also think about how can we make an infrastructure secure much earlier. Instead of finding the misconfigured infrastructure after the infrastructure has been built, with IAC, we can also look at the insecure configuration or vulnerabilities we can look at the code before the code is actually deployed. That's the beauty of IAC, that allow security or system admin to identify any possible misconfiguration or insecure configuration before the code is turned into a real data center. And now I will quickly go over the research that we did early this year. So in this research, we want to understand how people use IAC. So the way we did this in particular, we want to see, are people using IAC securely? And if the obvious answer is no. People always, there are always insecure configuration in any kind of environment. And we want to understand what are the insecure configuration or what are the top most commonly seen insecure configuration in IAC. So the way we did this research is that we pull all the CloudFormation, Terraform, Kubernetes, IAC templates that we can identify from GitHub. There are around 500,000 this IAC template that they pull from GitHub, and we also pull some of the data from Prisma Cloud. Prisma Cloud is the cloud security service offered by Palo Alto Networks. So we have some internal data as well that we can use. So we aggregate this data into a repository and design IAC scanner to analyze, to statically analyze this infrastructure as a code, and finally and get some statistic out of the data. And behind the scene, this is how our scanner works. We basically create many policies for each type of infrastructure as a code. For example, on the top left for CloudFormation, this is one of the policy in CloudFormation. This rule written in Go template identify if an AWS customer master key rotation is not enabled. And another example of in the Terraform policy on the right, again, we can write a template to identify if Azure keys role-based access control is not enforced. So there are many policies for each IAC, and customer can also write their customer can also easily add their own policy to the scanner to identify specific configuration. So the findings in CloudFormation is that we found 42% of all the CloudFormation configuration files contain at least one insecure configuration. And the two most important findings in CloudFormation is first, encryption. People are still not used to the idea of encrypt everything, especially data at rest. We have seen very well adoption of the HTTPS or transmission encryption, but a lot of time data are still not encrypted at rest. So S3 buckets are not, we have seen a lot of S3 bucket data in S3 buckets are not encrypted, or data in RDS database are not encrypted. And one may argue that I don't really need to encrypt my database because I already have proper authentication or authorization access control outside this database. But it's always a good idea to have your data secure at rest, because you never know, one day the snapshot of your database may be leaked. And if your database is not encrypted, this snapshot can then be read as plaintext. And a second finding is the login and is login or eventing. And people are not turning on the login and event. Login and event are especially important for security purpose, because you cannot protect. So suppose your S3 bucket data in your S3 bucket is leaked. Without logging, you cannot know who has accessed your data and or what data or what data object has been accessed. You cannot know the scale of your security incident. So logging is extremely important in terms of securing, auditing, and with logging, you can not only prevent security incident from happening, you can also it can help you detect potential security incident much earlier as well. And I will not go over the code example. These are the real code example that we found on GitHub and how CloudFormation can be misconfigured. So, and like, for example, S3 bucket just get published to the internet. There are some times that, for example, a web server, but a lot of times these are misconfigured, and that how data get like leaked. And in the Terraform, IAC, we found 22% of the Terraform misconfiguration files contain at least one insecure configuration. And the first key finding, again, is login and event. AWS S3 bucket login are not enabled, or event subscription are disabled. This all prevent you from seeing what is going on, what has happened in your cloud infrastructure. And the second biggest issue that we found in Terraform template is the public exposure. We have seen a lot of infrastructure just exposed SSH service or even or RDP remote desktop service to the public. SSH is a great service. It's convenient, but it is just too risky to be exposed to the entire internet. If you want to use it remotely, you should just create a whitelist of IP that can access to the service instead of opening it to the entire internet. Same as RDP and database. There's no good reason to expose your SQL database to the entire world. Usually there are just a handful of application server need to access the database directly. And if exposed to the internet, any hacker can identify and try to poke around. And finally, the Kubernetes YAML file that we scan, this is the Kubernetes file we scan. The two important insecure configuration we identify are the first, share the host network with the container. The problem of creating the container and share the host network to the container is that if this container is compromised due to the application vulnerability, the hacker can immediately access the network stack, the same network on your host, and it will put your other application on the host as well as other infrastructure access from the host into risk. So it's a very bad idea to expose. There are some times that you need to share the host network to the container, but usually you shouldn't. And the second issue, and the second important issue that we identify is a lot of containers are still running as a root or a privileged container. We all know it's a bad idea to run your application as a root, because if your application is compromised, then the hacker get the root privilege of the process. And with the root privilege, it is much easier to pivot from that point moving forward. And again, this is an example of how this misconfiguration looks like in the code. And it also, from just looking at this code, one can imagine it's not too hard to do static, to identify this misconfiguration from static analysis. And finally, these are the data pulled from our internal database from the Palo Alto Network internal service. And interestingly, we identify almost same kind of misconfiguration, same patterns in our private data set when compared to the public data set. 76% of the client have at least one of the SSH service exposed to the entire internet, and 69% of the client has at least one RDP service exposed to the entire internet, and the same login event in issue and the same encryption data at rest issue. was identified in internal data. Finally, let me quickly go over what how we can mitigate these issues. So visibility is important in the cloud environment. As I mentioned, in the cloud environment, you don't have physical access to your hardware. So you need to, if there's any event or login available from the cloud service provider, you should turn it on so that you can see what is actually going on under the hood. And enforcing security standards such as CIS or Zero Trust model. And finally, shift that. This is the focus. This is the focus of this research. We can also shift that to at we can now shift left at the infrastructure level because the availability of IAC template. We can scan the IAC template as early as possible before any misconfiguration made it to the production. And a few pattern and anti-pattern to remember or takeaway for the audience, enable cloud security service such as AWS Guard Duty, Azure Security Center, and GCP Security Command Center. So when enabling this security service, it also enable a lot of login or eventing service to help you increase the visibility of cloud data center, cloud virtualized data center as well as your service. And always encrypt, always lock, and always firewall. If the encryption option is available, always encrypt. If there's any log, always collect. And you never know when you will need this data, and they will become very, very helpful. And constantly scan, also I didn't really talk about the application vulnerability in this talk, but patch is again the number one, the most important way to secure your application. And this is this concludes my talk. And if anyone is interested in more detail about this research, we published a report to Unit 42 Cloud Threat Report that you can easily find online and download. This is a very long, I think 20 plus page report. Detail. Three part.